was there before there was creation, who illuminates the stars and sun, who has set eternity in motion. There is just the one. Who can calm the storm with just a whisper? Who can make the darkest demons run? Who can break the curse of generation? There is just the one.
The mighty Lion of Judah, the pure and spotless Lamb, the Alpha and Omega, the good and great I am, the God that saves the nations, the one they bow before. Let every voice sing out, who is like the Lord?
Who can carry sin upon his shoulders? Who endured the cross and scorned its shame? Who is like to rest like every other? But who rose again and stormed out of the grave?
The mighty Lion of Judah, the pure and spotless Lamb, the Alpha and Omega, the good and great I am, the God that saves the nations, the one they bow before. Let every voice sing out, who is like the Lord? Who is like the Lord?
You are the one true King, Lord over everything. Jesus, there is no other. Jesus, there is no other. Your word will never change. Your name is here to stay. Jesus, there is no other. Jesus, there is no other. You are the one true King, Lord over everything. Jesus, there is no other. Jesus, there is no other. Your word will never change. Your name is here to stay. Jesus, there is no other. Jesus, there is no other.
The mighty Lion of Judah, the pure and spotless Lamb, the Alpha and Omega, the good and great I am, the God that saves the nations, the one they bow before. So let every voice sing out, who is like the Lord? Who is like the Lord?
Guardian and keeper of my soul, lay to rest to make for us a home. Blameless, son, imperfect cornerstone, all my sin your sacred gift atone. Oh, the precious blood of Christ, how it held me through the night. Oh, it brought me back to life. And I am alive by the precious blood of Christ. Love has paid to make me whole again. My emptiness is filled with heaven's breath. And that same power that raised you from the dead, that spirit is alive inside my chest.
Of the living God, I take in the goodness of your love. I lean in closer to my Father's heart. I trust in who you say you are. You are alive, living and breathing here in this place. Speaking and healing your fullness and glory right here before me. You're the living God, the living God. fountain of your hope.
You are alive, living and breathing here in this place, speaking and healing your fullness and glory right here before me. You're the living God, the living God. You are alive, living and breathing here in this place, speaking and healing your fullness and glory right here before me. You're the living God, the living God.
Never gonna hold you, so it's never gonna hold me, 'cause you're the only thing holding on to me. Death is never gonna hold you, so it's never gonna hold me, 'cause you're the only thing holding on to me.
Death is never gonna hold you, so it's never gonna hold me, 'cause you're the only thing holding on to me. Death is never gonna hold you, so it's never gonna hold me, 'cause you're the only thing holding on to me. You are alive, living and breathing here in this place, speaking and healing your fullness and glory right here before me. You're the living God, the living God. Death is never gonna hold you, so it's never gonna hold me, 'cause you're the only thing holding on to me. Death was never gonna hold you, so it's never gonna hold me. You're the only thing holding on to me.
You are the living God, Lord Jesus, and I thank you this morning for your healing. Father, so many of us in this room are broken and hurting. But we know, God, here in your presence, we can be made new. We can be whole. Father, we thank you for your grace, your mercy, your goodness, and love. So we pray, Father, that your Spirit would just saturate us this morning. That you would fill our pastor and help us to hear the words that you want us to hear. Learn what you want us to learn, and fall more in love with you. We thank you for what you're about to do. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to continue our our study of the great influencer. And thank you, Chris, last week for doing a great job and just sharing the fact that our desires should really be influenced by Jesus. And that when our desires are influenced by Jesus, that we tend to do things a little differently because Jesus is in charge. And so just a great reminder. And thank you for sharing that, bro. And I always like to start with a question. So here's my question. If I say the word relationship, what comes to mind? Relationship, right? Maybe when I said that, you thought of your marriage. You thought, man, I've just got this great marriage, and I thank God every day that I've got my spouse, and man, we just share so much life and love together, and she's just the, she or he's just the, just my, they're the dream of my life, you know? Maybe you thought marriage and thought, you know, that's what I wake up to every morning. I'm sure Mama Bear has that effect, you know, so. Maybe you thought about your kids, like, do you have a great relationship with your kids? Or maybe a coworker? Or maybe your church family? I mean, when it comes to relationships, here's the thing, is that we were built for relationships. We were built for relationships. And relationships are all around us. We're in a relationship this morning as we gather here at the church. We're in a relationship with each other, and we're in this relationship with God. At least I hope we're in a relationship with God. And one thing I know from reading the Bible is this. God made us relational beings. He made us relational beings. We were not made to be alone. How do we know that? Because in Genesis chapter 1, it tells us that God sees Adam, that's human, not man, it means human, Be'adam, sees him and says, my goodness, it's not good that man should be alone. So God is a relational God, and he desires us to be in relationships. Here's the problem, is that today I feel like relationships have less and less significance in our lives. And as much as we have the influence of social media and the ability to connect with people all over the world at any moment, it's not the same as being like in that one-on-one personal relationship with somebody. I find today that most people have acquaintances, tons of acquaintances. Oh, man, I've got 1,000 people on Facebook that follow me. How could you possibly know 1,000 people? When I was a kid growing up, the mode for communicating with people when you weren't able to see them was what? Telephone, right? It was a telephone. If I could not see a friend, I'd get on the phone, dial their number, they'd pick it up, and we'd talk. And if they wanted to talk to me, they'd dial my number or my parents' number, and we'd talk. And hey, anybody ever remember the two-party lines? You guys remember that? My dad was so cheap, man. I mean, we had to have a two-party line growing up, man. And so if you don't know what a two-party line is, you had to share a line with somebody else. Could be anywhere in the city. And me and my sister were little devils, man. So we had figured out how to get on the phone and listen to the other person's conversations. So what you would do is you'd go over and you'd unplug the phone from the phone outlet thing, and then you'd take the phone off the receiver and plug it back in. They wouldn't hear that sound when it picks up. And we'd get on the phone and we'd listen for 5-6 minutes, and then we'd start talking smack at them, man, you know. Same, repeating back what they'd said and everything. And then about 20 minutes later, afterwards, the phone would ring and my dad would pick up the phone. It would be the phone company screaming at him because we were doing it. You're going to lose your two-party line, you know. And me and my sister just laughed until we got spanked, but it was still funny. So, but anyways, my point is that that's how we communicated. Today, what is the number one mode of communication? Text. Text is it. I kid you not. Everybody texts. Texting, and here's the thing about a text message. You don't know what's behind it. Me, I'm just straight up. I'm just, blah, that's it. I'm texting you, and I'm going to tell you what it is. It doesn't mean I'm mad or angry or anything. I sent out a text to some board members a couple weeks back, and they were like, oh, my gosh, why are you being so hard on us? And I'm like, not board members here at the church, board for the that I'm on in Dixon. And they're like, I'm like, I wasn't. I was just making a point, you know. But you can't tell in a text what the tone is. Most of you know me. After two or three text messages back and forth, I'm calling you because I have a text message limit. I can't stand a text to begin with, right? And so I'll keep texting with you. I know you're at work or something like that. But for the most part, I try to have a conversation with you because that's how God made us. He made us relational. He made us relational, church. Today's title of the message is Jesus is the Great Influencer. Because Jesus needs to be the great influencer in our lives, and especially with our relationships. Especially with our relationships. So let me rephrase that. The title of today's message is actually, Jesus is the Great Influencer in Our Relationships, right? Something like that. I don't know what I wrote. It's up there on the screen. So, anyways, hey, if you'd please stand, I want to read the Word of God with you this morning. We're in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2, Paul says, be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Let's say that together. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. God, as we go into your word this morning, may this verse become a foundational verse in our lives. Father God, we thank you for your word, that we can take it and absorb it. And God, that it changes our thinking and our hearts. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would teach us today, that your words would come from the throne. And thank you, Jesus, for the blood that saves us. You are the relationship maker. And thank you, in Jesus' name, all the church said. Amen. Be seated, please. If there was ever a verse in the Bible that sums up how the relationship should be within the body of Christ, it's this one right here. This is it. And Paul uses this verse in Ephesians chapter 4 to set up what he's going to talk about in the rest of the chapter. Chapter 4 is about our conduct inside the church. So he's going to talk about bearing with one another in love, and then he's going to go on from there and he's going to talk about having unity in the Spirit, that there's one God and one Spirit, and that we share that same Spirit and same God. He's going to talk about the way the church functions. He's going to let us know that God appointed apostles, evangelists, prophets, pastors, and teachers for what? To tell you what to do or lord over you? No, to equip you for the ministry. My job is to equip you for the ministry, not babysit you. It's to equip you for the ministry, to get you ready for what God has for you. He's going to go on to talk about the way that we should act with one another, that we should not grieve the Holy Spirit in our interactions with others. So we shouldn't be angry or jealous or envious, use harsh words with each other. Because when we do that, the Holy Spirit, it grieves him. That word grieve there means like when somebody dies, that's how much pain the Holy Spirit feels when we're not kind to each other. Chapter 4 is a no-joke chapter. And we buzz through that chapter. And we don't spend time focusing on what Paul is trying to tell us. So what I want to do today is I want to unpack this chapter, or rather this verse. And I really want us to grab the essence of what Paul is telling us today and the importance of what Paul is telling us in verse 2. Because again, church, it's foundational for you and I. And we need to take this verse and we need to put it into our hearts and our minds and allow it just to captivate us. So the first thing that Paul says is that we're to be completely humble. He says completely humble. Let me tell you what the word completely means in the Greek. It means complete. Get it? There's no magical word here. There's no back layer to this. Completely means completely. It means complete. He doesn't say be halfway complete. Sometimes complete. He doesn't say be complete with people that you like or those that you get along with. He tells us to be completely humble. Completely. Now, I don't know about you, but that seems pretty hard to do. Because I get in the way a lot. But yet Paul says we have to be completely humble, church. Now, what does humble mean? Man, I've heard so many terms about, oh, this is what humble is, or this is what humility is, blah, blah, blah. Let me tell you what humble is. Not proud or haughty. Not arrogant or assertive. A deep sense of one's moral littleness. Could you keep that up for me, bro, real quick? This is what it means. Not proud. How many of us have pride in our hearts? All of us do. We fight it. We struggle with it. But we cannot have any pride. Haughty, that means thinking that you're above people, right? Not arrogant, thinking you're better than people. Assertive, always that what my idea, my thinking, this and that, it's the only way or the highway. A deep sense of one's moral littleness. You understand that your morality is worthless in the sight of God. Outside of God, your morality is worthless. And so you don't go around with this moral compass on all the time. You realize that your morality is very little. Because we're flawed human beings, church. We're flawed. The best way to sum this up, I don't think I'm better than you are. That's what being humble is. That's what being humble is. Not thinking you're better than everybody else around you. Paul goes on to talk about this in Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. Paul says this, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interest of others. Let's think about what Paul's saying right there. He says, do nothing out of selfish ambition. How much do you and I do that is based on our selfish ambition? When God took me in the desert in 2007, I realized that I was full of selfish ambition. And I realized that very little ambition that I had was really coming from the throne of God. And God said, D, I got to wash you out of you. I got to get you out of the way, man, because you're causing me problems. And so I had to learn the difference between selfish ambition and God-driven ambition. There's nothing wrong with ambition as long as it's being driven by God. But when it's being driven by me, it's dangerous. Because by nature, I'm ambitious. By nature, I'm a driver personality. So I can run over people if I'm not careful. And that's not God either. So we're not to do anything out of selfish ambition or, he says, vain conceit. In other words, thinking that what you're doing or what you're where you're going or what your thought is way better than anybody else's. It's not. Again, us. We get in the way. What does he say next? He says, rather, in humility, value others above yourself. There's that word humility again. In humility, value others above yourselves. Listen, I am to value you above me. You're to value me above you. But we don't live that way. We live in the world of me. It's me. He says, not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interest of others. Church, this is what it looks like for us to be together in the body of Christ. This is huge. These verses, God gave them to me one Sunday morning in my brokenness. He said, this is your problem, D. because you don't understand this. And he just thrashed me over these verses. And I went to the altar and I said, God, forgive me, man. Forgive me for being so blind and not seeing the importance of others. Church, this is another set of verses, man, that you need to memorize, that you need to place into your hearts. Because I'm telling you right now, we would have a lot less conflict in this little church if we lived by this. Get us out of the way, Lord. Get me out of the way, God. So the bottom line here, be completely humble. It means being humble. I value you more than me. That's what humility is. I value you more than me. The second thing is Paul says, be gentle. Now he uses completely humble and gentle together. So again, we are to be completely gentle, not partially gentle, not gentle with just my family, but we are to be gentle all the time. Completely gentle. So what is being gentle in a relationship? What does that mean? What does it look like? Well, I like Webster's dictionary. I love the old Merriam-Webster's dictionary because a lot of stuff that he had in there as definitions, it was actually from the Bible, the words that were used in the Greek or the Hebrew or whatever. Brilliant man. Supposedly he memorized every word in the dictionary and could tell you the, the meaning, the definition, yes. That's incredible. Here's what he says about gentle. Free from harshness, sternness, or violence. Now, we can be pretty harsh, we can be pretty stern, and we can be very violent in the body of Christ. Paul says, no, that's not to be there. We're to be gentle. I like dictionary.com. I like what theirs had to say. It said, an absence of bad temper or belligerence. Do you have a bad temper? Are you belligerent? Are you the person that walks in and blows the whole place up? Gentle has reference especially to disposition and behavior. So your disposition and behavior, it'll be displayed. And when it's on display, it should be a gentle disposition and behavior. It goes on to say, and often suggests a deliberate or voluntary kindness or forbearance in dealing with others. And then it gives an example, a gentle pat on the back. You ever gone over and just said, hey, it's going to be all right. It's going to be okay, man. We're going to get through this. Don't worry about it. Or how gentle you would be with a child. I always watch how people are with children. If you're loud and obnoxious with kids, it tells me who you are. Because first off, kids don't like that stuff, man. When you're dealing with a little kid, they don't want that. That's not what they need. When you're talking to a child and you're like, hey, how are you? And you get down to their level, that's when they got you. Right? That's what they do. That's when they got you. They're like, yeah, hey, I got them. No, listen. That's how we should be. How you would gently pat somebody on the back, or how gentle you would be with a child. That's the type of gentleness that we should display with each other in the body of Christ. Jesus alludes to this in Matthew chapter 11, verse 29. Very famous verse in the Bible. What does it say? It says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am what? Gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Church, Jesus says, the yoke that you're carrying, this angry, belligerent, non-forbearing yoke that you have on you, remove it from yourselves, put my yoke on, and when you put my yoke on, you're going to find out something about me, that I'm humble and that I'm gentle. Jesus' yoke is humble and gentle, and it changes us. Because, see, now we're not striving. Now we're not working so hard. Now we're not fighting against God. No, now I'm yoked up with Jesus. And because I'm yoked up with Jesus, man, there's an ease that comes into my life. Some of you this morning are so restless. And you don't know why you're restless. It's because you have a yoke on you that is not of Christ. You're striving You're striving against God. And Jesus says, no, take my yoke upon you. And he says what? Learn from me. You have to have a teachable attitude and spirit. Because Jesus says, learn from me. These are his words, not my words. And he says, listen, the first thing you need to learn from me is that I am gentle and humble. Well, if Jesus, the one who can raise people from the dead, the one who went to the cross, willingly went to the cross and did what nobody else could do, the one who walked on water, if he is gentle and humble, then man, I better be. He's our example, church. Jesus is our example. Learn from him this morning. If you do not have a gentle spirit, then you need to find out why. Because it's a mark for us in the body of Christ. The next thing he says is be patient. Ooh, I don't like this word. It's in big letters too. Patient. I don't like patient. Patient is not a, right? I lack patience. I really do. Because I want things done. I don't like procrastinating. I just get it done. Stop. Just get it over with. But Paul's talking about being patient in our relationships. And it's not always easy to be patient with others. It's not easy. Because we're all different. We all have different expectations. We're at different places in our journey. We're, you know, some of us are mature in our walk. Some of us are babies in our walk. Some of us are teenagers in our walk with Jesus. I mean, we're all at different places. And so it's easy for us to lose patience with each other. It's very easy to. But yet, it's paramount that we have patience in our lives with our brothers and sisters in Christ. We have to. A lot of times, people don't meet my expectations. I set deadlines or do this or do that, and it doesn't happen. And man, oh man, I just want to blow up. But there's a quote that I read. And it's an anonymous quote. I don't know. I can't give the person credit. It's just anonymous. But this is what this quote said. It said, patience is when you're supposed to get mad, but you choose to understand. Like raising my sons, there was tons of times, man, I should have just went off the hook and smashed them into little pieces. And everybody would have said, yep, they deserve it. But there would be something in my heart in that moment that would say, no, there's something deeper going on here, man. Don't react to this. Respond. And so I was patient with them. Now, I ain't going to lie. They'll tell you there were times I smashed them into pieces because they did have it coming, and that's just the way it was back when we were back in the day. You do that now and they'd lock you up in jail. So yeah, I mean, you know, don't spank your kids, because my gosh, you know. But the bottom line is this, is that when we're supposed to get mad and we don't get mad, that's a sign of maturity, and that's a sign that Jesus has your heart. That means Jesus has your heart. So here's what I want you to understand about what Paul said in the first part of this verse. Humility, gentleness, and patience, guess what? These are all personal choices. You can choose to be humble, gentle, or patient, or choose not to be. It all falls on you. And there are no excuses. My dad told me this, and you've heard this too. My father used to tell me all the time, nobody can make you mad, only you can. And that's the truth. When I hold myself in check, when I don't allow my emotions to start getting to me, I'm cool. But when I start letting my emotions get on me and everything else, then I'm not cool. You cannot make me mad. Now, you may make me want to respond to you. That's different. But I better not respond to you in anger, because that's not right. That's not the Lord. Not even close to being Jesus. So it's a personal choice to have these three things. And if we operate with those three things in our lives, humility, gentleness, and patience, then the second part of this verse will make sense. Paul says, bearing with one another in love. Bearing with one another. When we are operating with humility, gentleness, and patience, then we can bear with one another in love. Now, I want you to notice what he doesn't say here. He doesn't say just bear with each other, right? That's tolerating each other. And we're not called to tolerate each other. That's not in the body of Christ. He says to bear with each other in love. I'm not to tolerate you. I'm to love you. How many of you this morning are tolerating your brothers and sisters? How many are tolerating them? Because if you are, then you better get before God and stop tolerating them and start loving them. Because it's clear in the Word of God that if we are Christ's disciples, then we will love one another. Now, I may not like what you do, and you may not like what I do, but I need to love you. You need to love me. And too often, we are tolerating each other. And that's not the way we're supposed to be. That's what happens in marriages. They tolerate each other. Well, how is that a healthy marriage? That's not healthy. Right? I go to work and I tolerate my coworkers. I go to work and I tolerate the traffic. I tolerate social media. I tolerate this. No. If you're tolerating things, change your disposition. God did not tell us to tolerate. God told us to have an impact. And we have an impact through love. Our greatest example of this is Jesus. Think about Jesus. He calls these 12 dudes. Now, everybody thinks that the apostles were like these bumbling idiots, three stooges type of guys and stuff. They actually were very intelligent dudes, and we know that by the way they write. We know that by the gospels. We know that by the letters that were written by them. We know that they were actually intelligent guys. They weren't just some dumb fishermen that just, you know, barely could talk and walk. No. Jesus knew who he was calling. He didn't call the wise, but he did call people that understood the languages, understood the culture. But Jesus, here he is with these guys, fighting over who's going to be the greatest, right? Peter telling him, you can't go to the cross, get behind me, Satan, right? He's got these cast of characters, and Jesus loved them. He didn't tolerate them. He loved them. He loved them with all his heart. And he poured into them and he gave them everything that he could. Well, church, if he's the example of how we should be in a relationship with others, then we should follow it. And that's how we should be. Proverbs says that iron sharpens iron. We sharpen each other. But we shouldn't be cutting each other. We should be sharpening each other. But we cut each other. We cut each other with our words. You know, all the time. It's, you know, it cracks me up. I'm not talking bad about this person, but. Well, if you throw a but in, you're talking bad about them. Right? I mean, there's no other way to put it. I don't want to say anything about this person, but. But you're going to. Does that make sense? I mean, it makes absolutely no sense to me. But isn't that how we are? Oh, I need to tell you this so we can pray about this person. Then you tell them every single juicy detail there was, man, every word that was said. But then let's pray. God help them. Amen. You know, right? That's ludicrous to me. But that's how we treat each other in the body of Christ. We treat each other with such disdain. And Paul says, no, I want you to love each other. I want you to bear with one another in love. It's in love, church, that we do this. And so when I'm putting God first, when I'm putting Jesus first, when I'm living by what Paul tells me here with humility and gentleness and patience, then even when I have a confrontation with somebody, God's going to be in the middle of it. God's going to be in the middle of it. Church, this morning, some of you have some broken relationships, man, that you got to get right. I'm sorry. You got to get them right. It may be with somebody here in the church, or it may be a family member, or it may be a friend, whoever it is, but you've got to get it right, man. You know why? Because you represent the King. See, Jesus came to fix relationships. And here's the thing, is that you may be the only Jesus that they encounter. What do I mean by that? Because you have the Holy Spirit in your life, because you have Jesus and you represent Jesus, you may be the only Jesus that they're going to really come into contact with. And yeah, man, it might be rough. There might be a lot of hatred or anger or bad feelings that are there. But because we belong to the Lord, we are called to be what? Peacemakers. Jesus said, if you know your brother or sister holds something against you, you leave your gift at the altar and you go take care of it before you bring your gift any further, because if you bring it, it's worthless. God will not honor it. So a lot of times you're bringing stuff to God. You're bringing your tithes. You're doing all this type of stuff. But you have broken relationships out there and you're blaming everybody else. There's nobody 100% right in a relationship. You have brought your things to that relationship. You go make those things right. I can't control you, but you can. But I can control me, right? Okay, I got that right. That's the truth, church. I knew this message was going to be a tough message today, man. But it's the truth. I had to check myself. I had to go back to somebody this week, and I had to fix a relationship that was broken from 10 years ago. I had to hunt them down. I said, look, man, I know what my part was. I didn't expect them to apologize or nothing. I wasn't looking for anything other than to say, man, this is my part. And I'm sorry, man. Forgive me. Forgive me. That's all I was looking for. If you go to fix things so they can tell you you're sorry, save it. Just save it. Because your heart's not right. You want them to apologize to you. You go, you make it right on your end. Leave the outcome to God. Let God handle it. Some of you this morning have a broken relationship with God. You think it's good. You think it's good. But it's not. It's really not a good relationship. Because you're miserable inside. You're angry. You're hurt. You're upset, you know? You're fighting with the culture and all this other stuff. Church, listen, man, those things can have an effect on us and take us away from who God wants us to be. And He wants us to be in love with Him and to trust Him and be in a relationship with Him. Jesus came to fix that. He came to fix your relationship with God. Why? Because Jesus is the great influencer. And when we let Jesus influence our relationships, they will be 100% different. Now, I'm not saying I get along with everybody 100%. I don't. There's times when I have conflict. But I will tell you this, 99% of the time, I get along with people. Because I'm not trying to prove I'm right. I'm not trying to push things down people's throats. I listen to what others have to say, but these are things I had to learn in my 35 years of walking with Jesus. You have to learn these things. Why? Because Jesus said, learn from me. Church, this morning, if you have broken relationships, man, come to the altar. We have men and women who will pray for you. Let's pray over those relationships and ask God to give you the strength and the courage to go and fix them. To go fix them. Nothing is impossible with God, but we always think it is. There's no relationship that God cannot heal. Now, I'm not saying He will heal everyone, but there's not one He can't. Maybe your relationship with God is not where it's supposed to be this morning. Maybe you're allowing things to sneak into your heart and into your life that should not be there. Come to the altar and pray with these brothers and sisters. Open yourselves up to the influence of Jesus and watch what he does. He will change everything in your life, especially your relationships. Amen.